EML is the flagship lecture series of IIT Madras, and we conduct year-long lectures and interviews with distinguished speakers from various realms, including administration, politics, arts, media, among others. To take forward the legacy of the team, today we have with us Ms. Ira Singhal, IAS, one of the top bureaucrats in service today. Ms. Ira Singhal topped the UPSC Civil Service examination in the year 2014 and is the first differently abled woman to do so. She's a BTEC graduate and an MBA holder. Currently, she's the Deputy Commissioner in the Office of Divisional Commissioner. She's also the Brand Ambassador for the Department of Disability under the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, as well as one of the Brand Ambassadors for Ministry of Women and Child Development, as well as Niti Aayog. She has won several prestigious awards, including the President's Gold Medal for acing the IAS training, India Today's Woman of the Year 2015 Award, and many more. We are honored to have you as our speaker for today's lecture, which will throw light on the topic inclusive governance and the way forward. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for having me, to the whole team. You know, as a person with disability, inclusion is something that has personally affected my life, and I see the consequences of a non-inclusive society around me more than anything else. And when it comes to government, it becomes even more imperative. See, the purpose of government is to make sure that every single person in the country is a part of the progress, is a part of the development, right? So if it is, so what government does is it makes policies, plans, and programs, which, work for the betterment of people, which work to develop people, different groups of people. Now, if you take a simple situation, and I'm a person who has, a background living in an urban area, and I've always had electricity and I've always had water. Now, when I and all the people in the team who are making that plan and the policy or the program are people who come from that urban area and who have always had electricity and water. What will happen is that when we make the policy and plan for the whole country, we won't make a plan which works for people in areas where they don't have all the running water and don't have electricity, right? Because if it's ways a one single perspective, which is the one that is forming the policy, program, project, it's going to be not a very healthy and a very widespread policy, and it will likely fail. And we must remember that if in a country only 50% of people are doing work and are living up to their potential, they then have to carry the physical, financial, and emotional burden of all the others who aren't. Because see, when you are someone who's financially independent, who are empowered, that also empowers you in all the other spheres. If I'm someone who earns, I will have the kind of capacity needed to make decisions for myself, right? Which means that I can live my life by my choices. I can make sure that my existence is only dependent on me. But if I'm someone who doesn't earn enough, then I'm dependent on other people to make choices for me. I'm dependent on other people to guide me how to live my life, right? And what that does is that person who is going to make those choices and decisions for me, it takes away from their time. It takes away from the energy that they have for themselves, right? So it's a burden on them, and it's a loss of me as well, because my contribution to the country, to the development, to the economy is not there. So why do we need inclusive governance, right? We need inclusive governance so that all of these people who are not a part of the normal growth story come into the picture, to make sure that all of these people get that platform where they can perform and they can deliver. Because if there is development of, carried by on the shoulders of just a few people, they won't be able to do so much, right? There is just a limitation of how much they can produce, how much time they have, how much energy they have, and how much potential they have. But if I have everybody else also contributing, let's say in a family, there are 100, four people, one person earns 100 rupees and the others don't earn anything. So now that one person who's earning the 100 rupees, he gets only 25 for himself. And not only is he the one who has to earn, because other people are not empowered and are not working, they sort of depend on him to take the bigger decisions as well. So his time and energy goes into that as well, right? So all of his effort is now, his earning, which he was doing at 100, is available to him only at 25. And a lot of his time and energy is also going into taking care of others in other ways. So for that person's own health and well-being, he's not getting enough, right? But if, let's say, all the three other people contribute something to the family income, let's say not 100, someone does 50, someone does 30, someone does 20, they all together make 200. Now, every single person has 50 available to them, right? Which is instant doubling of the income, even though all the others weren't earning as much. But it's something that they earned. So, which is why when we have an inclusive governance, governance, we mean policies and programs which take care of everybody, which give opportunities and platforms to everybody. What happens is that everybody gets a chance to contribute. Now, if everybody is contributing, the burden on those who were the only ones contributing earlier goes down. The time available to them for themselves, for their own recreation, for their own mental health, for their own physical health, for their own lifestyle choices is a lot more because others aren't taking away their time. And they have a lot more money for themselves. So together, the whole country becomes richer because A, the contribution also, see from 100, it has gone up to 200. So the family obviously became richer, right? Similarly, the country will become richer. And similarly, the whole economy grows up by that much. And, and so here we are talking about everybody contributing to whatever is their potential. And that's why we need an inclusive governance because we need policies and, perspectives into the governance, which will help us produce results, which will allow everybody else to be a part of the story and everybody else to be empowered, to be developed, to, do things that they can contribute for the country. I'll give you a small example. Very recently, I was working in a policy on transgenders and we were trying to make laws for them and we were trying to make, programs for them. Now, as a person who is not a transgender, there is only so much that I know about them. And there is only so much that I know about their lifestyles and about their needs, right? So I was making all these plans and policies in which I thought would be the priorities. But what we did was we called all the other NGOs who work in the sector and who are led by other transgender people. And we asked them to tell us what they needed. And the kind of ideas that they came up with were very different from what we thought. For example, and it's a slightly sad thing, but you guys are old enough, I'm sure, to understand the realities of life. But what happens is that if a transgender person dies, and most, you must remember, in a country like ours, families generally throw out transgender people. They throw out their children who are transgenders. They let them be taken away by groups of transgenders, right? So now if a transgender person dies and he doesn't have a family, he's living on the road, there is no one to take care of this, to do the last rites of this person. There is no money to do last rites of this person. And with police, the problem is we as an administration do the last rites. But generally, when we would do the last rites, we would do them as male or female based on the organs of that person, right? But we won't be doing it according to how that person lived. And that is the whole argument behind that person's existence. The reason that they were on the road and not with their family was because they were different. And we at the end moments would again be mistakenly taking away that dignity and their identity from them again. So the demand that the transgender group came up with was that we need money for the last rites of our people. We need money which will help us give them a dignified last moment. And that's not something that we had ever thought about. And that's not something that we ever knew about. So if I don't bring those people into the conversation when I'm making those policies and plans, they won't be fit for them. They won't get what they really need. And now here comes the other aspect of this. Because I'm making, I bring them into the conversation and they told us about the education aspects that they needed and the kind of trainings and all that they needed. We had discussions and with that, we came up with what would be the best possible policies for them. Now, if I was letting them, I wasn't making those plans and policies which suited them, what would happen is that they would continue to be at the fringe of the society, which means they would still be in those rent-seeking activities, which if any of you is an economics student, you would understand. But rent-seeking is generally where you try to get money from others without putting in work. So, so they would be begging and getting the money without actually contributing anything to the economy, right? Without actually contributing anything to the country. So what that does is that whatever was their potential has been taken away from the country. And all the money that was going to come from them to contribute to the country and to take care of them, now that money is being withdrawn from the country to go to them to take care of them, while they could have been contributing at the same time. So we're at a double loss. And that's why you need an inclusive government. Also, every single person has a right to get to live the way they want to, and a right to a dignified existence, a right to able to contribute, to earn, to be empowered. And that is where inclusive government comes in, because if everybody has that right, then we need everybody's voice to be a part of the conversation, and we need everybody to be brought into the development cycle, to be brought into the policies, to be brought into everything. And you must remember, everybody has a different perspective, you know, and when you get people with multiple perspectives, the things that you come out with are a lot better and a lot, produce better results. So in that respect as well, you need an inclusive government, because different perspectives will give you different ideas and will give you different ways of solving the same issue. And some of them might be better than what you thought of. So, I personally think that that's very, very important. And as a country, we've woken up to this reality in the last 20, 25 years. I believe we have actually woken up to the reality of how important it is that everybody is a part of this conversation. Everybody is a part of these programs, is a part of the governance itself. So, to really be delivering justice and to really be delivering growth and prosperity at every corner of the country, we need to bring everybody from everywhere in. And that's the road ahead. There are still some sectors that we haven't really done much for, but with the current frameworks that we have, we've sort of tried to, address issues with each sector. So all the sectors which are traditionally, and by this I mean social sectors, which means people groups, which have traditionally been backwards, we've been working towards them. So we've got, policies and programs for this women, for the disabled community, for the transgender people, for backward classes, from tribal groups. So all of these are being addressed. Yes, it has been a slow road. It's taken many years. And I think the latest, in my opinion, we've added is the transgender group. And there are, I'm sure, still a lot of groups who are not a part of the conversation. But at least we've woken up. And now the government is a lot more responsive in terms that we quickly listen to people and we realize that that is something that we've missed on. And we're bringing that in. So an inclusive governance is not about giving something to someone else. It's also about us. Because if I don't have to support everybody else in my family, and if they can contribute, because the government, the country and the government made it so that they could contribute, that they could find jobs and they got an education and they got, employment, and they, for people with disabilities, the infrastructure became accessible so they could go out and work, right? If government has done all that, then they, all of those people in my family will contribute, and my time for myself, my earning for myself goes up. So from a very selfish perspective as well, we need inclusive governance just for ourselves, just for every individual of us to have a better life. You need everybody else to also have opportunities.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your insightful words. So we'll go straight into the questions. What factors are preventing the benefits of social programs from reaching the needy? Is a quick improvement possible, or would we need structural changes to achieve this?
So the bigger problem that we face is the lack of awareness. See, what happens is all of these groups are backward because they don't have access to information. See, you must remember, and with the internet age, you kids will be very, very aware of this, that information is power, right? Information is what helps you grow. Information is what takes you places. Now, the problem is that all of these groups that are left behind in the development cycle are ones who do not have access to information. So the problem that we need to solve primarily is that we need to make sure that information reaches all those people. So for example, there are a lot of scholarship programs, but most kids are not aware of where they are, how to apply to them, what is the extent of them, you know. So that is why the benefits of all these policies and programs are not reaching the right people. Because, and you know what, government does have websites, government does have programs and all, but somehow people are, that connect between individuals realizing that you can go to that website, that gets missed out somewhere, you know. I think that's the problem, that all of these segments, which is women in the rural areas, people with disabilities, transgender groups, because they don't have access to information that easily, or they don't know how to access information, you know. Because see, today on internet, everything is available. The problem is you're not aware of how do you get that information. You're not aware that this information exists, and hence you're not hunting for it. And because of this, you get left behind from the development cycle and from the programs and policies. So I think that's the focus that we need to solve, that we spread awareness about these things.
All right. Sushant Vadavkar from the Mechanical Engineering Department has a question. He asks, it is said that there has to be less government and more governance. Could you throw some light on the self-sustaining and automated form of governance backed by efficient administration? How can it be achieved?
By less government and more governance, what we mean really is, let's look at this phrase, is basically that the government has to withdraw from the non-essential activities. Currently, government, and not currently, over the years, government has been involved in a lot of activities which traditionally you would not need government to take care of. But that was because India did not have a robust market place to adjust to those things, right? Of course, there are certain sectors like education, like healthcare, where it is very important for government to exist and the government to take care. COVID crisis, I think, has made everybody aware of that. And you guys are studying in IIT, so you know how important it is for these kind of institutions to exist, where anybody from a poor background can come in without worrying about how will I pay the exorbitant fees that a private sector college would charge. And talent can be nurtured, right? But when we talk about less government, we talk about all the other places where it's we traditionally had a lot of regulations and rules, and it was an inheritance from the British, where they did not trust us, they did not trust the Indians, so they wanted to control every aspect of our lives and every movement that we made, and it was something that we inherited from that. But today the awareness is a lot more, and we're slowly withdrawing from things that are non-essential, and the trust between government and citizens is increasing, because once that trust increases, and it has to be on the both sides, it can't be just people trusting government or government trusting people, right? It has to be both sides trusting each other, and then the government can withdraw from them. So for example, recently government has been withdrawing from the airports, the management of airports, right? Because if you logically think about it, why does government need to be doing that? Can that not be supported on a financial basis? Because see, you must also remember that the money available with government is also limited, right? So if you get into non-essential activities, activities that can be maybe handled by the market sector, what you're doing is that you are spending all that tax money, which could have gone into social sectors and sectors where really public, government delivers public goods. Public goods are things like your roads, your bridges, things that everybody uses and nobody really pays for, right? So those are the things that are public goods. So government really needs to be doing those things, your education, healthcare, pension schemes and all of those, rather than, getting into things which could be financed through, user pay models. So that's what we mean by less government and more governance, in terms of more making it more user-friendly, making it more easy for people to be a part of the governance cycle, more easier for people to take part in the governance, and easier for people to manage their own lives on themselves. So there is no self-sustaining and automated form of government because if it's a democracy, it is automated. It's self-sustaining and it is coming from the people, right? Because what does democracy mean? For the people, by the people, and from the people, right? So I don't know how you mean self-sustaining and automated form of government, because this is not a machine. This is made of people. And when you talk of people, you don't really think of human beings in terms of self-sustaining and automated. You must remember that the biggest, the client of the government is every single human being in the country. So when, and the government is formed from amongst those human beings. So it's not a machine and it's not an automated system which will do something, right? What I think you're trying to mean IT systems. Well, they are being used in most departments. In fact, that's one of the mandates that most of us have, that we try and do everything as much IT-based as possible and remove people from those. So for example, if you want to apply for a pension today, you go online and you apply. You don't have a person sitting there where you need to go and you kind of have to apply. But you must also remember there's a problem right now. What happens is that if I put every single scheme on a computer, I'll give you an example. With pension schemes, what happens is that we've got them all online. Now, the problem that comes in is there is a person who's a rural villager. See, remember, who needs pension? The person who needs pension is the person who's either very, very old, or is a widow, or is a person with disability, which means that they are anyway not capable of using the same systems that you are. Remember, you are healthy 18 to 24, 23, 24 year olds. The way, the kind of energy and the health that you have, those people who need the pension don't. So if the pension has to go to an old person who's an 80 year old, he doesn't know how to use a computer. He doesn't have access to computer most of the time. So what will he do? He will still need to go to someone in the cafe who will explain it to them. Now, here comes another problem. All of these pension, all of these online things will be attached to a phone number. This old person may not have a phone. Even if they, so suppose they don't have a phone, what will the cafe guy do? The cafe guy puts in his phone number, and phone numbers are linked to bank accounts. So the cafe guy now starts getting his pension on his papers. And this guy, who's the old person who needed the pension, doesn't get it, right? So those kind of problems also come in with IT. So it's not a blanket brilliant solution. You must remember that there are elements which will create problems. Now, for example, if this person starts filling a form himself, he doesn't understand most of what he doesn't know what what those documents he may need to upload, and he doesn't know how to upload. He doesn't know how to scan those documents. He doesn't know how to log in or get a password or set a password, right? And those kind of problems come in because see, when we're talking of a lot of the things, when you're young, you only think of the things from your perspective. But think about it from the perspective of a guy in some rural part of India, where A, there is limited internet access. If there is, then that person may not know how to use it, right? And they may get all sorts of scams into their system. So it's still a double-edged sword. Maybe 30 years from now, when we're all old, that time, since we would have been working on internet and all, it would be much easier. But today it still isn't. A lot of people who are old businessmen, they still don't feel comfortable using internet for their transactions, using internet to pay their all of those things. Because see, it's very easy to think that why not when you're young. But as you get older, your capacity to absorb new things goes down. So when we deal with populations that are already in those spheres where they are limited in their capacity to understand, it's very tough. So you must remember that everything has a different perspective and a different side to it. I hope that made sense.
Yes, ma'am, certainly. Now, Ganesh Ramaswamy from Applied Mechanics Department asks, what part does the general populace and neutral media have to play in ensuring inclusive governance? and what are the challenges that they face? What suggestions do you have to tackle them?
So general, do you mean people who are politically neutral? That's what I understand that you mean from this. Inclusive governance is actually about everybody getting to have an opinion. What generally happens is that all of those people that you're talking about are the ones. See, if you are neutral, you will not have an opinion on the issue. And hence, you will never come to the government and tell them that this is what you're doing wrong or that you're doing right, right? So neutral doesn't really work in governance. You need to have an opinion. If you're neutral, you will not take part. So to have to take part, you need to not be neutral. You need to have a viewpoint. What we prefer is that people with differing viewpoints, people who are who've got different perspectives and who don't agree with things and who don't like this and that, they come and tell us this is what needs to be done and this is what needs to be done. Because if we get 50 different perspectives, we'll be able to balance them out and we will be able to come up with something that works for the larger group. See, nothing will ever work for everybody. Okay, because everybody's needs are different. Everybody's requirements are different. As individuals, even you and I are different people, right? We have different backgrounds. We have different ways of thinking. We have different experiences. So our needs will be different. So there cannot be a single idea or a policy that will, solve everybody's problem. But what we do is we aim for something that solves the larger group's problem. And unless the larger group has an opinion about it and comes and tells us about it, we won't be able to give them a government which suits them. So inclusive government is about having opinions from everybody and perspectives from everybody. And neutral people do not give you opinions and perspectives. It's only people who feel for an issue, who have a side that they want to pick, who come and tell us. So from that perspective, it's neutral people don't make a difference. They're just silent and they sit away. So if, for example, if it's an issue about building toilets in rural areas, as an urban city developer, I don't care. So I will never have an opinion. And I'm a neutral person, right? I will not take part in that issue. But when it is to building a toilet outside my house, I will have an opinion. Right? I will have an opinion and then I will get in. And that time I'm not neutral. So as a citizen, we don't need neutral people because they don't have opinions. They will not tell us what they need. Our point is to solve people's problems. So if you're a person who's neutral, you don't have problems, right? So my whole point of being the government is to solve your problems so that you can have a better, healthy, developed life. And if you are neutral, that means you don't have problems for me to solve. So then you're not a part of my governance process. So no, neutral people, a neutral, this thing, general populace does not, this thing. But if you're talking about neutral media, neutral media is people who are not politically focused, but are issue focused. So what that does is they bring out that different perspective to us and they tell us that helps us analyze where we were going wrong, or that helps us analyze the issue from a different perspective. And hence we can make a better policy. So the neutral media, if you mean non-political media, ones who examine issues for themselves, then we really, really need them, because what that does is that gives us a different perspective, a different way of looking at things. And that gives us an opinion of other people's perspective, right? Which we may not be carrying. And they also tell us when we're doing something right or wrong. But unfortunately, neutral media is not really something that exists that often. Because remember this, that all human beings come colored with their opinions and perspectives, right? So it's very tough to find a completely rational and neutral person to give you a perspective. It doesn't happen.
All right, ma'am. You have been an advocate of inclusive schools and the importance of education in inculcating empathy and values in education. So how inclusive and value-oriented is our education system now, and what is the way forward?
I think maybe our textbooks are inclusive, but the problem is our transport system is not inclusive. So when we're talking about a child going to school and all children studying in the same classroom, if there are certain children who cannot come to the classroom, who can't make it because there was no conveyance available to them to come to classroom, we don't have an inclusive classroom. We have an automatically biased classroom. So we are still some way behind inclusive classrooms. And I remember when I was a child, a lot of schools rejected children like me. And by the way, I did not have a mental disability. I just had a physical disability, which also in my case did not affect my functioning as a student. But still, the schools would refuse admission simply based on my disability, right? Because back then, schools were a lot less inclusive. And today, that happens a lot less. I will not say that doesn't happen at all. It does happen. I do hear cases of children being refused admission, but it does happen a lot less. So we've moved to a more aware and a more inclusive society for sure. Value-oriented, I don't think we are still. Though, of course, I have huge hopes that the new education policy will bring us to that. But I don't think the value part of it is being incorporated today as much as it was back then. And I'll tell you the reason why. Today, education has become more competitive. So when it's competitive, you focus on things which will get you ahead in life. And that doesn't necessarily mean values. Because values are about being about living a happy life and about living a life where you also create a happy environment around you, which means you live in a society wherein you support other people. But that takes away from the competitive part of it. And a lot of schooling today is very competitive. And because of that, I personally feel we've lost the value-oriented part of it. And we need to bring that back, because if it's all competitions constantly, then you don't learn to collaborate. You just learn to, compete, which takes away from that. And that actually does create the problems.
Okay. So a large number of NGOs are springing up nowadays with the aim of bringing about social change and addressing pressing social issues. So what advantages and limitations, if any, does a bureaucrat have over such NGO members in achieving the same desired goal?
That NGO can work for a longer term on focusing on a specific issue. For us, it becomes very tough to focus on one small segment for a longer term. By the way, you must also remember, most of these NGOs actually work on government programs. So, we don't always have the manpower to tackle an issue. And that's where the NGOs come in. So they bring me that manpower, that number of people, the foot soldiers that I need on the ground for a particular, to connect with the community. That's what they bring in. I do not have that many people in the department. And also you must remember, if it's a small intervention that needs to be done for, let's say, 6 months, it's very tough for government to hire people like that, right? And if I hire people like that, I will have to keep paying their salaries in long term, right? But they are a surplus to me. I don't really need them after that program. That's where the NGO comes in, because they can hire people to do just that issue. And those people can then move on to a different area, to a different project, to a different issue, right? We can't do that in government. It becomes tougher for us. So that's the one gap that they fill a lot. And most of the NGOs, by the way, are working with governments on a lot of social issues. So for example, if you want to spread sanitation awareness in an area, we'll tell a local NGO who's been working with the community, and they have, because they work on different issues within the same geographical group, while we work on sectors. So for example, my one department would be sanitation department. Now that they deal with sanitation of the whole city, so I won't have people who would be very, very focused on one area and will have that deep community connect. So what NGOs do is they help us in a lot of issues from geographical perspective. Also on issues, because they live with the communities day in and day out, they kind of have deeper bonds with the communities and hence can bring us the problems a little better. So NGOs sort of bridge that gap for us. And a lot of our burden, also a lot of times we may not have the financial resources to really take care of the small things that are needed for a big project, right? So I may have money to build the pipeline, but I may not have money to, you know, do the small cleaning around it, or just pipeline is the wrong example, but, you know, I may have money to build the toilet, but I don't have money to hire, you know, people to go talk to all those households to use that toilet. That is something that the NGO may have, because they can have funding from other sources, right? Which is your CSR activities and all of that. So that kind of, they help bridge that gap. They help bring in those resources that we don't have as government a lot of the times. So that way they are very, very helpful to us.
Okay. Aditya Suresh from the Electrical Engineering Department asks, since politicians are more powerful than IAS officers, is it possible for civil servants to do real work, or do they merely follow the instructions of the political executives? Is there enough room for your innovations and plans?
Absolutely. You must remember that most of the good politicians want to deliver something to the people that have elected them. So if you have, and I have always been able to give a good plan and innovation. In fact, most politicians appreciate if you come up with a good idea and a plan. And remember, you are the person who actually has the technical knowledge. So it's bureaucrats who actually define all the policies and programs and this thing. The politicians just give us their input and the direction that they want us to go in, but we are the ones who basically make that. And if you have any innovative ideas, yes, absolutely. See, the point is, we're supposed to work behind the scenes. So you don't really get to see the kind of things that we are doing, the kind of ideas we are generating. Because if I work in a ministry and it's my project and my idea, the credit will still go to my minister. And that's how it should be, because I am technically working under my minister to make the ministry do well. So it's not me as an individual, it's actually my ministry. And hence the ministry is defined by the minister. So you will hear that the minister has done these things. But it's obviously us who bring that into fruition, and us who bring in the the technical expertise and a lot of the times the idea expertise as well. So yeah, there is no dearth of work for someone who wants to do.
Parveen Kumar from the Department of Maths asks, what was your motivation to join civil service, and how much you are satisfied with the service you are providing to the nation now?
My motivation was simply that I wanted to do something wherein I was making a difference to the larger society. I needed my job, my day, to have meant something to someone else, to have made a positive impact on someone's life. And that was the only reason I got into the civil services. And I think I've been very, very lucky that I did get a lot of opportunities. And I've gotten opportunities out of turn, out of, the usual work profile that I would have had. So I'm very, very lucky. I've been working with CBSE on the career guidance, career counseling module for the whole country. I've been a part of the accessible election panel. So Election Commission's National Panel for Accessible Elections, I'm a part of that. So I get a lot of these opportunities and I'm very, very satisfied with being able to do those things and to be able to bring in those ideas. So yeah.
Having cracked UPSC civil service examination in your very first attempt and getting into IRS, you joined IAS overcoming many challenges, including legal hurdles. So your perseverance is indeed inspiring. What was the most challenging time in your life so far? And how different would your life have been if you had given up at that stage?
You know what? You guys don't actually know my life story as such. So as a person with disability, and trust me on this, life gives you a challenge every single day. Having to go to court for UPSC and all for civil services exam was just one of them. It wasn't the biggest, not at all. It was one of the big ones, but it was definitely not the biggest. And you always have the option of giving up. But then what are you left with if you give up? You always have to look at that. What do you have left? What have you got to show for yourself if you give up? And I do give up when I realize that this, pursuing something further would be a waste of my time and talent. I do give up at that point. But that is a choice that you need to make, and that is a decision that you need to make. So it's not that I don't give up. I do when I realize that putting in more time and energy on this particular thing will be fruitless henceforth. And that's a skill you need to learn very early in life, because a lot of people get emotionally attached to something and they keep chasing it and they keep putting in efforts on that, which is completely wrong, because there are certain things that you may not be able to achieve, but you must remember there is always something that you can achieve. So what I do is I try to look at every situation and see what is my next step. And my next step could very well be to move out of that situation and to move into another different situation. You know, that one door closes and another one opens. I really believe that happens. But that door will not open on its own. That door is something that you need to create. 99% of the time, you will need to create that door. So for example, I'll give you a small college-based example. You were trying to, in college, there would be a lot of times that we would get discriminated against as girls, and we would be told that because you're girls, you can't head a society. And that happened to me 2-3 times, that because you're a girl, how can you head a club, or how can you head a society? And what we did was we launched a new different society and club, and we ended up doing a lot more work and a lot better work. So it's all in the way you look at it. And it's all in the way that you, you want to look at a situation. So stepping away is also a good thing at times, because what you can do is then focus on building something better. So, for example, if you're in a job and you are completely dissatisfied with what you're doing and your boss is horrible and your colleagues are horrible, why not quit and start something of your own? If you have an idea and if you have the potential, right? Or switch a job. So that's not giving up. That's moving away from the situation and creating a better option for yourself. So I've done that also a lot of times, but there are times when I believe that the right thing to do in that moment is to stick it out and to give it my best. And the one thing that always keeps me, the way I analyze something is there something that I can change about myself which will make the situation better? Did I do something wrong? Is there my actions? Is there a positive action I can take to improve the situation? If there is an argument with someone, can I go and apologize? Can I go and discuss it calmly with them? Can I, and I don't have an ego problem. I do not have an ego problem. I don't bring in my ego into things and I don't think, oh my God, why should I? That never happens. I do not ever think, why should I, like that. That why should I let them do this? And they are horrible. I always try to see, what did I do that I got that reaction? What did I do where I was, incorrect and that I need to change? So that's something that I tend to do a lot. And it is very tough. It takes a whole lot of practice for many, many years to reach that point where you can do that to yourself. So, and that's what I do. And I don't hesitate in asking for help. If I can't do something on my own, I freely ask for help. I'm a very short person. I can never bring down books from the top shelves. So I'm always asking people for help. I usually can't lift my luggage when I'm on trips, so I will ask for help, right? So it's fine to ask for help when you need it, and take the help and then move on, because it's a society. Man is a social animal. We all help each other in some way. You can just pay that forward. You can just go help someone else. I do those things, and I, if you stop thinking from your ego and you stop thinking of yourself as someone, it's important to have a solid self-identity, but it is also important to not have an overestimated self-identity. So don't be arrogant about your existence, and don't think you are the center of the universe, and a lot of your problems get solved by that. So if you feel like giving up, just for a moment, take a pause and think, were you wrong somewhere? Were your actions incomplete somewhere? Can you improve on them? Can you make that situation better by changing yourself? Because remember, you cannot ever change anyone else. You can only change yourself. So if you can, then then I go ahead and do that and then wait for the results. But if I can't, then I move on to a different situation.
Thank you, ma'am. With that, we come to the end of today's insightful lecture. I, on behalf of the entire IIT Madras student community, extend my gratitude to Ms. Singhal for sparing her precious time for us. Thank you, ma'am, for your thoughtful and visionary words. And to all our viewers, we hope you found this lecture engaging. Stay tuned to our channel as we'll be back with exciting lectures soon. And don't forget to like and subscribe our channel. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.